is in urgent need of some shock therapy to get back to growth. Well, those are the words of David Davis, the MP for Houghton, Price and Howden. In a speech yesterday, Mr. Davis said that time was running out for action, saying that we're in the 11th hour, if not the 59th minute. Well, amidst calls for urgent economic action, David Cameron is in the process of his first major cabinet reshuffle. It's going on as we speak. David Davis, who gave that speech, is joining us on the programme today. Mr. Davis, good afternoon. Good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
Very good to talk to you. Fascinating, interesting speech. You think we're making heavy weather of the deficit reduction. If that's the case, could our future of low growth and go on for a long time?
Yes. I mean, what I did yesterday was I took a number of other countries as examples, and one of them, Japan, had a banking crisis a bit like ours, but 20 years ago, 1990. And they didn't face up to the problems. They didn't sort out their problems. I mean, in Japan, face is very important. They did a lot of saving face, but they didn't actually solve the problem. And they've had 20 years of growth, which is 3% lower than what went in the previous 20 years. I mean, Japan used to be the great sort of driving force in the modern economy. And then all of a sudden, bang, it went down to 1% a year for 20 years. So it does demonstrate that if you don't grip these things, they can go on for a long time. And the Japanese have had a whole lost generation of talent, people who can't get jobs. Today we've got, what, 1 in 5 graduates out of jobs, over 1 million youth unemployed. We've got a moral responsibility to sort that out.
There is a really big variation, isn't it? I mean, it's interesting. I was looking from your speech, what you said about Switzerland. Our unemployment, 8%. There's 3%.
I know. It's astonishing, you know. And it's not because Switzerland is in some way a barbarous country. It's a very civilized country, you know. But they do things just a bit different, and they spend a bit less of their state, as it were, their economy on the state, about 35% versus about 45-50% for us, and their employment regulation, whilst it's not uncivilized, gives a lot of leeway to small companies and doesn't give quite so much problem in losing people if, you know, if the economy is shrinking or if the company has to shrink in size. So what that means is that people are happier to take people on at the beginning. So there are all sorts of differences which I had a look at. I mean, I looked at Switzerland, I looked at Germany, I looked at Australia. I didn't count that in because it's so different as an economy, a long way away. I looked at Japan because of the problems they had, and a number of others which I didn't talk about because there weren't lessons to learn. But it was I look back at what actually worked in the past.
The bottom line is, for people listening, if they spend more at the end of each month than they have earned, then they are going to go into the red, or their credit card is going to go up, or their overdraft is going to go up. And that's what we're still doing, aren't we?
We're still doing that. I mean, for every £5 we spend as a government, we only get £4 in tax. We have to raise the fifth pound by borrowing. So, you know, we are actually, although the government struggling with a deficit, it's actually only going to, it's going to still have £600 billion more debt at the end of the parliament than it had at the beginning. So, you know, we're not going out of debt, we're going further into debt.
And yet you, I mean, because the common sense thing to say now is, well, if you put the taxes up, then you would raise more money from people and that would sort it out. But it's not that simple.
No, it isn't. I mean, if you increase the rate of tax, a number of things happen. I mean, firstly, people do less of whatever it is you're taxing. If it's work, they work less. If they're saving, they save less. If it's spending, they spend less. If it's investing, they invest less. So you actually get less tax than you think when you increase taxes. Secondly, of course, they spend more time avoiding those taxes. They employ accountants. I mean, I deliberately had this speech yesterday in the Grand Hall of the Institute of Chartered Accountants to sort of make a point. You know? So they avoid it. And of course, in the final analysis, it bends the economy out of shape and you make less tax again. The other way round, if you cut taxes, sometimes, not always, but sometimes, you actually get more tax back. That's what happened with Thatcher when she cut the top rate of tax. The rich ended up paying more, believe it or not, because they stopped trying to avoid the tax all the time.
So it is bizarre. You lower taxes, but you still raise more money than you expected.
That's right. More than you expected, and sometimes more than you did before. It's not always the case. And of course, the converse of this, when you put taxes up, you get less money, and that's one of the reasons why last month, for example, I think the deficit went up by some billions more than it did last year. You know, it's actually getting worse at the moment because the growth rate's gone down. The more growth rate goes down, the less money you raise. You know.
So just briefly, income tax. Would you cut income tax?
I would actually. I mean, I would cut right across the board. But the most important tax is not a popular tax to cut, but it's important, and that is the employer's national insurance, the amount of money the employer has to pay when he employs somebody. This is actually a tax on jobs, and what I would start with is the employer's national insurance for small companies, because the other point I made in my speech is that big companies actually don't add much employment to the economy. I mean, I used to be a director of, and previous to that, an employee of a FTSE 100 company. My job was making it more profitable. Every year we made it more profitable, every year we increased the revenue, and every year we employed fewer people because we were getting more efficient. Now, nothing wrong with that, because that's what preserves the jobs you still have, but big companies do that all the time. Small companies, when they take off, you know, when they really start going from 5 to 500, they grow like billio, they grow like gangbusters. So, and it's them you've got to encourage.
So this idea of punishing the rich, and there was much debate about this when they were talking about the top rate of tax, politically a real vote winner, but not the answer.
Yeah, well, particularly at the moment. I mean, when people are feeling the pressure, they want everybody to feel it, and not unreasonably want the rich to feel it most. But you've got to decide, you know, are you going to punish the rich, or are you going to harvest them? You know, are you going to get the most out of them? And punishing the rich tends to drive them away, tends to make them employ expensive accountants and all the rest of them. We've all seen the Jimmy Carr stuff of, you know, the fancy tax avoidance regimes, all that sort of nonsense. But if you change it, you say, no, what we want to do is we want to get the rich people to come here, to invest their money here, to put their resources and energy here, and then we'll get the most out of it for society as a whole. That's the mindset you've got to address it with as a government. And I took Mr. Clegg's head on this, because, you know, the idea of just adding more taxes to the rich, you end up driving people away. They go to Switzerland.
Will he listen to you?
I think in some ways, more importantly, is whether George Osborne listens, and I think he will. I think it was quite interesting when they knew that this speech was coming, there was suddenly a flurry of activity over the weekend, of a couple of articles and interviews and so on, about the sorts of things they're going to do. You've now seen this idea of a small business bank and so on was being floated. And when my speech was raised with George on Sunday, he very carefully didn't disagree with it. And I think that's where the point of influence
very, happened. Very, very interesting. The reshuffle is going on at the moment.
Yep.
Your phone line is busy at the moment, so nobody. I've got you on the
camera to come across the line and say, get off the line, Levy.
Are you expecting
No, I would be incredibly surprised if I got a call. I think what they're going to do, quite properly, I think, is to try and put a bit of a new face on the government. And truth be told, I actually think today's is the least important of the reshuffles. Tomorrow you got all the middle ranks, and tomorrow you're going to have the new brightest youngsters coming in, and there are a few that I think really well deserve promotion, who've really shown themselves to be pretty good in the last year or two. Dominic Raab, who's was my chief of staff, Elizabeth Truss, Andrea Leadsom, some good women actually, Andrea Leadsom, and one or two others who I think will show a new face of the Tory party. It'd be good for us.
Health Secretary Andrew Lansley is being demoted to the leader of the House of Commons.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I'm not surprised. I mean, there's been quite a struggle over that health bill, and some of it was unfortunate, I guess. And I think David Cameron decided they want to put a new face on it. I think Jeremy Hunt's got, you know, going to have his hands full.
Are you surprised that he has got what in effect is promotion after everything that's gone on?
Not really. No. I think in a way it's probably wise to move Jeremy out of DCMS. I mean, all the pressure on him and so on because of the Murdoch stuff. It's probably wise to put him somewhere else and bring a new face in there too. I mean, Jeremy's a very talented young man. I'm quite a fan of Jeremy Hunt, and I think we haven't seen the best of him yet. He really needs a testing job, and this will be a testing job to show how good he is.
Always very good to talk to you. I'm not going to keep you on the phone because if David is trying to get through, I do not want to block because you've been a good friend of the show and friend of mine. I don't want to go and.
I'm going for a walk in the park.
Very good to talk to you.
And you.
Bye.
Contact Peter Levy.